New evidence shows experts have dinosaur extinction all wrong. Perhaps no animal, living or dead, has captivated the world in the way that dinosaurs have. But what if everything we thought we knew about these prehistoric creatures turned out to be wrong? When one paleontologist began excavating a dig site in the mountains of North Dakota, he soon discovered a lost piece of dinosaur history that may change everything we thought we knew about the terrible lizards that once ruled the world. Most people would consider a preoccupation with bones concerning, though Robert De Palma's love of the dead and buried was anything but peculiar. An aspiring paleontologist, the 37-year-old managed to turn his lifelong passion into a curator position for the Palm Beach Museum of Natural History. But De Palma was perhaps best known for the widely publicized discovery he made near Bowman, North Dakota, in 2012. After receiving a tip from a private fossil collector, De Palma and his team began excavating a site along the well-known Hell Creek Formation. Initially, De Palma felt the site, dubbed Tanny's, had little promise, something the collector had made him privy to prior to the excavation. However, after returning to Tanny's in 2013, the paleontologist discovered there was more to this unassuming patch of rock than met the eye. Just a few meters below the surface, De Palma discovered a host of rare and unusual fossils, including those of species he claimed to have never seen before. It was an incredible find, though one set of bones in particular caught De Palma's eye and left him positively stumped. Beneath the skeleton of a freshwater paddlefish, De Palma discovered the tooth of a mosasaur, an enormous reptilian predator that made its home in the oceans of the early Cretaceous period. This puzzled De Palma and his team, for there was no way this creature could have existed in the fresh waters of prehistoric North Dakota. The layout of the find was also unusual, the fossils deposited haphazardly and some skeletons even buried vertically in the dirt. Combined with the fact that tektites, small bits of natural glass created from meteor impacts, were also present, everyone was left scratching their head. Then, a light bulb went off. Could the tektite fragments found in the Tanny's deposit have been scattered here by the asteroid that wiped out the dinosaurs? While some researchers would be quick to accept such a theory, the plausibility of this scenario isn't exactly cut and dry. The widely held belief that an asteroid impact caused the Cretaceous Paleogene extinction event is primarily based on the presence of the KT layer. This 66-million-year-old band of Earth stretches over nearly the entire globe and contains a high level of iridium, an element primarily found in asteroids. This theory is also supported by the Chicxulub crater, a 112-mile impression in the Yucatan Peninsula that contains the same mineral makeup as the KT layer. Therefore, most scientists assume that the asteroid that created this crater scattered the iridium debris that ultimately wiped out the dinosaurs. If this were the case, then one would expect to find plenty of fossils in the KT layer. After all, it was during this time that nearly all life on Earth went extinct. However, this actually isn't true at all. Hardly any fossils have ever been found in this layer of rock. In fact, most fossils are found about 10 feet below the KT layer, which, geologically speaking, would amount to thousands of years between the death of these creatures and the fateful asteroid impact. Therefore, it seems highly unlikely that an extraterrestrial object reduced every last dinosaur to rubble. Proponents of this alternate theory do still believe that an asteroid impact finished off the last of these prehistoric creatures, though they propose that factors like large-scale volcanic activity and climate change had already wiped out most of the dinosaurs by this point. However, according to De Palma, the Tanny's find was the key to finally putting this debate to bed. Not only were the fossils he discovered located within the KT layer, but their haphazard placement suggested they were deposited here just moments after the asteroid struck. With this information in mind, De Palma posited that the mile-high tsunamis created by the impact must have traveled up river valleys and into freshwater bodies, which is how the mosasaur tooth came to be here. This was big news. Eager to share his discovery with the world, De Palma sat down with the New Yorker to share the exclusive details of his historic find. However, as soon as the story broke in April 2019, the paleontology community grew outraged. Many of De Palma's colleagues were upset that the paleontologist had chosen to share his story with the New Yorker instead of a reputable scientific journal. De Palma later published his discovery in Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, though many felt this account was significantly less detailed than his New Yorker piece. Even prior to this, however, De Palma was considered by some to be a controversial figure in the world of paleontology. In 2015, he introduced a new species of dinosaur he'd recovered from the Hell Creek Formation dubbed Dacoteraptor, though after presenting the completed skeleton, it was discovered one of the bones belonged to a turtle. De Palma also stirred up controversy with his business practices, as he retains all control of his specimens even after they've been placed in museums and university collections. He also reportedly funds his field work by creating replicas of his finds and selling them to private collectors. But the strangest discrepancy of all may be De Palma's record of the discovery itself. While the paleontologist and his team have made claims about the large number of dinosaur fossils uncovered near the surface of the Tanis deposit, his article in PNIS only mentions one example in a supplementary document. As of now, additional papers on Tanis are being prepared that will hopefully clear up the confusion surrounding De Palma's find. Until then, one can only wonder if De Palma's discovery will truly change history or simply wind up as the fabrication of another would-be hero in search of fame and glory. The good news for De Palma is that we're constantly learning more about world-changing impacts in our planet's history. In 2020, he took note when experts from Rijksuniversiteit Brussel and Utrecht University published a study in the American Geophysical Union Journal. Their findings not only revealed a mind-blowing secret about our planet, they may also help to provide new information about the moon. What's more, these discoveries have all been made through close analysis of a long-extinct relative of the modern-day clam. At the center of the study was a shell. The mollusk that the team studied dates back to around 70 million years ago, shortly before the dinosaurs were wiped out. It's part of the Torates Sanchei species, which belongs to a now-defunct group called Rudis clams. These organisms are notable because they built up their shells in daily growth layers, a trait that proved particularly useful for the research team. According to the IGU, T. Sanchei mollusks resembled tall pint glasses with lids shaped like bear claw pastries. They consisted of a pair of shells, or valves, and these were connected by a hinge which was akin to an asymmetrical clam. Apparently, they were most commonly found in water warmer than our oceans today and grew in thick reefs. The mollusk analyzed in this study originated from a shallow seabed, where it lived for more than 9 years. The once tropical area is now totally dry and sits within the mountains of modern-day Oman. But back then, it was home to clusters of the mollusks until they disappeared in the same extinction event that's thought to have eradicated the land-based dinosaurs. The study's lead author and analytical geochemist at Rijksuniversiteit Brussel Niels de Winter told IGU in March 2020, "Rudis are quite special bivalves. There's nothing like it living today. In the late Cretaceous especially, worldwide most of the reef builders are these bivalves, so they really took on the ecosystem building role that the corals have nowadays. 70 million years later, that same clam has become an ancient recording device, chronicling Earth's secrets within its layers." Through carefully conducted experiments, De Winter and his team were able to extract mind-blowing revelations from this unassuming shell. Their findings have helped to confirm long-held theories surrounding ancient Earth and beyond. Yes, the study has even helped experts understand more about our moon and the role it has played in the evolution of our planet. While the shell has undoubtedly unlocked doors to new findings, scientists already know quite a lot about what life was like at the time. Dinosaurs still roam the planet, for instance, as the end of the late Cretaceous period approached. Geologically speaking, the Earth was in the Maastrichtian stage of the Mesozoic era, which covers from 72.1 to 66 million years ago. Over the 79 million years that constituted the Cretaceous period, the planet underwent substantial changes. At its beginning, the planet's landmasses were arranged in two supercontinents, Laurasia in the north and the huge southern island of Gondwana. But both had already begun rifting, and by the end of this monumental age, the continents as we know them today were starting to take shape. North America continued to drift away from what is now Europe in a shift that had begun during the earlier Jurassic period. And this, of course, further widened the span of the Atlantic Ocean. India was still planted next to Madagascar, but it was now adrift and beginning to move northward. Australia, on the other hand, was still connected to Antarctica, moving away from Africa and beyond the South Pole. The climate cooled considerably over the Cretaceous period, but it was still much warmer than today. Instead of ice sheets, forests covered the poles and it allowed dinosaurs to wander Antarctica. However, as the planet cooled, these and other non-equatorial forests became more temperate. This effect was experienced across the Earth, bringing seasonal weather to the northern and southern hemispheres. The aforementioned climatic changes ultimately gave way to the emergence of grass, deciduous forests, and flowering plants. The latter proved particularly important, with their rapid growth providing a food source for many animals. The proliferation of plants was also aided by a rash of insects, including beetles, ants, wasps, and bees. Nevertheless, the enormous grasslands that would come to cover swathes of the planet were still a few million years away. The late Cretaceous period also saw many well-known dinosaurs come to the fore, as new species evolved and the power balance shifted. The Tyrannosaurus rex rose to the top of the food chain in the north, while the Spinosaurus did the same in the south. In addition, the northern continents were home to herds of herbivores such as the Triceratops. Meanwhile, the shifting continents created the necessary conditions for reptiles and amphibians to thrive. The expanded coastlines became home to all manner of beasts, including crocodiles, salamanders, turtles, frogs, and snakes. The skies were dominated by enormous pterosaurs, but they found competition from the increasingly diverse array of birds. In fact, the ancestors of many present-day birds can be traced back to the Cretaceous period. While fossil records show modern birds can be traced back around 60 million years, a 2008 study which appeared in the journal BMC Biology revised that estimation by some 40 million years. As a result, it's thought that the lineage of pelicans, sandpipers, cormorants, and more all began in the Cretaceous period. Life prospered on the shores, in the skies, and in the oceans, too. The plesiosaurs were replaced in shallow waters by the snake-like mosasaurs during this time, while modern sea creatures including sharks and rays became commonplace. And coral reefs continued to blossom in warm waters, formed of rudest clams like the one analyzed in the 2020 study. While much of life on Earth in the Cretaceous period is well documented, less is known about the cosmic conditions at the time. But thanks to the aforementioned shell, that may be about to change. Indeed, the positively ancient fossil has revealed an astonishing secret about the planet's rotation, and in turn, it's provided scientists with enough knowledge to estimate the length of a single day on Earth some 70 million years ago. Prior to these recent revelations, scientists did have a general grasp on how the Earth's rotation has changed over the years. We know, for instance, that it has been going on for almost the entirety of the planet's existence. But because the change has been so slow in the grand scheme of things, it has been almost impossible to track year on year. The planet's day-night cycle increases in length by roughly 1.7 milliseconds every century, according to Scientific American. That's not a statistic you'd ever notice, of course, but over millions of years it can make an enormous difference. The phenomenon is driven by the way the Sun and our Moon interact with Earth on a cosmic scale. Effectively, it's all caused by gravity and the tides. You see, the Moon is gradually spiraling away from the Earth at a rate of approximately 1.5 inches every year. NASA's James Williams described the effects of this trend to the publication in 2010. The senior research scientist explained, "You're putting energy into the Moon's orbit and taking it out of the Earth's spin." The Moon's gravity controls the tides in our oceans, which outpace the former planet's orbit due to the speed at which the Earth rotates. The resulting displaced mass pulls the planet forward, while the Earth's rotation is simultaneously slowed by friction on the seabed. Together, these factors result in the imperceptible extension to the length of our days. Our years remain the same length, however, because our planet's orbit around the Sun remains constant. To discover the rate at which the Moon is pulling away from Earth, Williams pointed lasers at reflectors left behind by Russian probes and U.S. astronauts in the 1960s and 70s. First, he calculated the time it took for the beam to return to Earth. Then, Williams compared changes between multiple results to reach the current figure of 1.5 inches per year. Generally, the trend established by studying the Moon is that the further back you go, the shorter the days were. But the tricky part is figuring out their precise length. Australian National University geophysicist Kurt Lambeck told Scientific American, "As you start going further back in time, the records get difficult to interpret. But the records have tended to support a general pattern going back that the number of days in the year increases. Analyses of the Earth's tides can also tell us more about how the Moon was formed. Indeed, the data supports the dominant theory that the lunar body collided with our planet some 4.5 billion years ago. If it formed elsewhere and drifted into Earth's gravity, Lambeck said, the tides wouldn't have remained constant. Furthermore, Purdue University Earth and atmospheric scientist Jay Melosh added that our world had a speedy 6-hour rotation immediately after the moon impacted the Earth. Over billions of years, the moon has drifted from its initial orbit of 16,000 miles to its current distance of 239,000 miles. As a result, the Earth's rotation has apparently slowed 4 times over. And that's what's still happening now, as the moon continues to pull further away from the planet. But to really trace the exact length of a day between those two epochs, you need to dig deep into scientific evidence. And the aforementioned fossil mollusk studied by De Winter helps us discover how the length of time in a day has changed. Owing to the way it progressively builds its layers, the researchers could use the rudest clam to accurately measure how long a day was 70 million years ago. The scientist added to Cosmos magazine in March 2020 that the shell is a bit comparable to tree rings. By carefully studying these lasers, the scientists determined that back then, the Earth rotated 372 times a year. That adds up to 7 more days than our current year, making the average length of a day 23 and a half hours. Effectively, then, a day on Earth when dinosaurs roamed was actually half an hour shorter than it is now. We have about 4 to 5 data points per day, and this is something that you almost never get in geological history, De Winter told IGU. We can basically look at a day 70 million years ago. It's pretty amazing. To do so, though, the research team had to make very careful use of a laser on the ancient fossil. This technique allowed the scientists to examine the shell's composition at a scale not visible through microscopes. First, they used the laser to fire tiny holes into the fossil in order to gain a clearer understanding of its layers. They were then able to extract those layers in minuscule increments. Each layer peeled back in this way was equivalent to approximately a quarter of the growth incurred over a single day in the clam's life. The researchers then used that data to extend the fossil's rate of growth over a 9-year span. From there, they could accurately determine the length of a day at the time the shell was in its prime. This allows us to measure how the composition of the shell changed over short time periods and learn about very rapid changes in the shell's environment, De Winter told Cosmos magazine. And from those findings, he continued, count the number of days in a year, because we can also see seasonal cycles. Most climate models of the ancient past examine changes taking place over tens of thousands of years. However, this mollusk has allowed researchers to drill down into changes occurring over the lifetime of a previously living organism. Indeed, as well as the length of a day, the shell has also been able to accurately reveal climate conditions 70 million years ago. For instance, analysis of the clam has shown that temperatures of the oceans in the late Cretaceous period were actually warmer than previous estimates. Winters were as hot as 86 degrees Celsius, while summers reached a blistering heat of 104 degrees Celsius. According to De Winter, those temperatures were likely reaching the maximum that mollusks were able to withstand. Rudist expert Peter Skelton, who wasn't involved in De Winter's study, commented on the team's findings to IGU. He said, the high fidelity of this data set has allowed the authors to draw 2 particularly interesting inferences that help to sharpen our understanding of both Cretaceous astrochronology and rudest paleobiology. The research has essentially provided the most accurate reading yet of the length of a day in the late Cretaceous period. What's more, it has also helped to fill in some of the blanks concerning the moon's rotation and influence on Earth. That's because while the lunar planet recession rate currently stands at around 1.5 inches per year, the experts believe that it's impossible for that to have always been the case. If the recession rate had never changed, it would mean the moon would essentially have been inside the Earth just 1.4 billion years ago. But we know that the former planet is much older than that, having likely collided with our planet around 4.5 billion years ago. That suggests, then, that the rate at which the moon is pulling away has changed over time. Astonishingly, tracing a 9-year span of this ancient clam's life has helped scientists better understand those changes. Talking to Cosmos magazine, De Winter said, the evolution of the Earth-Moon distance must have been more complex, but we don't know exactly how. This type of measurement helps astronomers create better models about how the Earth-Moon system behaved from the moment of the formation. 70 million years is really just a fraction of the moon's history, however, so it's no surprise that going forward, the study's authors hope to apply their new laser-focused method to even older fossils, and in doing so, they hope to capture similarly precise snapshots of the differing lengths of days further back in time. The scientific potential of these fossils doesn't end with studying the moon, though. Indeed, they also allow researchers to analyze environmental changes on a daily basis. Acknowledging that it's a slow process, DeWinter added, think of large storms on very hot days. It's hard to find fossils as well preserved as the specimen we used, and the work takes a lot of time and effort. Nevertheless, the ability to interpret weather patterns in such detail has big implications for studying ancient climates, according to DeWinter. And in turn, it can help inform scientists about what's to come. He concluded, "We climate scientists are very interested in such reconstructions. They may teach us how patterns in extreme weather and climate will evolve in the near future."